Hi, everybody.
Morning. It's great to be here. I've only been back in town for a few days. I'm teaching in Maine. We're doing this strange experiment where I'm teaching in Bar Harbor for 5 months of the year, and then I come back for the rest. And so I'm still reeling. I just got back on Monday. Now let me see if I can. Okay, good. Okay, so I'm going to talk about wonder today, not as an academic. I always make this distinction. I developed a seminar at OSU when we moved back from Maine the first time, and I titled it Negotiating Wonder. And it was mostly because I looked at the students, and this is, I've been teaching college art majors for about 20 years, and I noticed that the students were always paralyzed whenever I gave them a free project. Whenever I said, you can do whatever you want, they were just terrified. Every time, these are art majors, and these are junior and senior undergraduate BFA candidates. So I thought maybe something that we could do is go back to childhood and consider this notion of wonder. There had been a lot of discussion in the art world about curiosity, wonder cabinets, curiosity cabinets, wonder commerce. And for a long time, it was getting curiosity and wonder were being discussed in the same breath, but they're fundamentally different. Wonder is a form of learning, an intermediate, highly particular state akin to a sort of suspension of the mind between ignorance and enlightenment that marks the end of unknowing and the beginning of knowing. So wonder is this very split second, ineffable moment. And when I was developing the seminar, I really thought that art did that for me. Whenever I go see an art object or a museum, I'm confronted with this thing that confounds me. I don't know what it means. I may know nothing about the artist. And yet, if I engage this thing on its own terms and I make myself ignorant in relation to it and I partner with it, I can develop a relationship to it. So when I'm talking about wonder a lot of times, I always use the example of, it's as if you're taking two magnets of like poles and you're pushing them together, and there's that one moment where you can balance them, but if you push any harder, they slip. You can't actually connect them. And that's really all we can do when we're discussing wonder, is we can bracket that zone of inquiry, that moment which completely dismantles your cognitive abilities to process what happened. Whether it is the most significant sunset you've ever seen, or a traumatic event, we've all experienced some kind of life-changing moment in which you're at a loss for words. Wonder for me is inherently a visual experience. I'm not saying that it is always visual, but as a visual artist, that's how I respond to it. And when I was working on the seminar, I realized, I thought I'd do some research and I'd find all these books on wonder and the visual, and all of these art exhibitions on wonder and painting or sculpture or ceramics or whatever, and there was nothing. There was one book published on wonder and the visual arts by Philip Fisher. Was titled Rainbow and the Aesthetics of Rare Experiences, which is another way of characterizing wonder. Descartes is one of the first people to discuss it as the foundation of philosophy. When our first encounter with some object surprises us and we find it novel or very different from what we formerly knew or from what we supposed it ought to be, this causes us to wonder and to be astonished at it. Since this all may happen before we know whether or not an object is beneficial to us, I regard wonder as the first of all the passions. It has no opposite. For if the object before us has no characteristics that surprise us, we are not moved by it at all, and we consider it without passion. This is what I like to call the wonder face. This is a still from a fantastic movie called The Spirit of the Beehive by Victor Erice. And this is the character Anna. This is very famous in cinema because this moment, in the film, she's viewing the film Frankenstein, the James Whale version of Frankenstein. But she's actually viewing this for the first time. And he captures her expression watching this film. And, you know, she's curious about it, and you can see her facial expression, and then a kind of paralysis happens. The mouth drops open, the eyes get wide, ears are alert, nostrils are ready. You are completely cut down at that moment. Cognitively, you don't know how to deal with this thing that you're experiencing. So wonder is an opportunity to reorder your relationship to the world. That requires you to to establish a point of view and to commit to seeing things differently. This is an art installation. It's an anamorphic projection where if you stand in one particular spot, anamorphic projections are stretched perspective. The whole image comes into being. This most people would consider to be a wonder, the Aurora Borealis. It is on my list. I have not seen it yet. I get alerts up in Maine, and every time I get one, I drive up to Cadillac Mountain and sit there in the cold waiting for something to happen. But we're a little too south. One of the great things about being alive today is the internet. You can access all of these different fantastic, amazing experiences. How often do you look up something on the computer and you talk to friends, say, hey, you got to see this, come over here, you got to see this. But I think in a lot of ways, the internet has also kind of homogenized this experience of wonder. You get used to it over time. So this is Frederick Edwin Church's painting of Aurora Borealis. Versus the internet, where it's a virtual image, you're dealing with an actual painting, you're dealing with the physicality of paint, you're dealing with the size, the history, the smell, the way the light falls off the texture, the frame, all of those things. This is a personal experience that you can articulate by yourself. As I was trying to figure out these ideas of wonder, I started thinking about all the other kind of inexplicable conditions that are related to wonder. So in this chart, which I made, this is version 7. This is a working chart, and it seems maybe a little absurd to put wonder into a diagram, but in my research, I realized that almost every analysis of wonder was either through philosophy or literary criticism, and they were always using structural analysis. And I always thought that was so strange for such a slippery concept. But I think that's all you really have when you're dealing with something that is liminal and is ineffable. So I divided this idea of wonder into conceptual experiences and material experiences. Curiosity and novelty are at the beginning of the chart, which lead to the grotesque. The grotesque, for me, is a strategy that artists can deploy in order to make things strange. So the grotesque doesn't necessarily have to mean blood and gore. It can be the decorative grotesque. It can be the conflation of many different parts of incongruent things. It can be the slamming together of two opposing ideas. So it is a structural kind of methodology that you can use to get you a little bit closer to the edge of wonder. From there, you deal with issues of beauty, which then has a relationship to wonder. And right up the middle of the column there, we talk about the marvelous and astonishment. The marvelous and astonishment in material experience being that experience that you have when you see a fantastic object, a painting or a very rare mineral or something in an ethnographic museum that really just reorders your conception of the world. Towards the top, you're dealing with more conceptual experiences. So those might be things like dealing with death. Wonder is not always a positive experience. There's dark wonder. It might be dealing with something that is so large that we can't comprehend, like the gravitational waves that they just discovered or they just proved. Then when you go from wonder, that's kind of the family there. Fantastic, the uncanny, horror, the abject, and terror. So I'm going to talk about a little bit of these things as I go through, and then later on you'll see this again. But I just wanted to put it up there so you can kind of think about these conditions of wonder, which is what I tend to call these. All of these share a similar experience. In fact, that wonder face that you saw earlier from Anna is also the same face you'll see when people are horrified by things. This is from Edith Cobb, a remarkable book called The Ecology of Imagination in Childhood. It's not very well known. If you are an educator, I highly recommend you get this thing. It's a very small book. She basically spent her entire life writing this one book. She was a friend of Margaret Mead, and in it she has a lot of incredibly wise, prescient commentary about education. This was published back in maybe the 50s or 60s, I can't remember, I'm sorry. But we're talking about all these issues right now. She says, the sense of wonder is spontaneous, a prerogative of childhood. When it is maintained as an attitude or as a point of view in later life, wonder permits a response of the nervous system to the universe that incites the mind to organize novelty of pattern and form out of incoming information. The ability of the adult to look upon the world with wonder is thus a technique. For us, we need to work on it a little bit more, an essential instrument in the work of the poet, the artist, or the creative thinker. This is a painting by Victorian fairy painter John Anstruther Fitzgerald. That is a subgenre of British painting, by the way. This is The Death of Cock Robin. And what's interesting about fairy painting for me is a lot of these paintings were an excuse to paint. Basically, there's a great movie called Fairy Tale, and it stars Peter O'Toole as Arthur Conan Doyle and Harvey Keitel as Houdini. And they have this argument about the supernatural and what is real and what is artificial and so on and so forth. And the interesting thing about that era fairy tales and fairy paintings and the various hoaxes that were perpetrated through the new invention of photography is that these painters took this very seriously, and funerals were very common in fairy painting, because in the fairy land that was the only time where all the different fairies came together. So it had a kind of function to it. This is one of my childhood wonders, and I'm sure I share this with many, trying to figure out what the heck this is and chasing these things. Just constantly trying to collect as many as I can, put them in a jar so it can light my room. But it wasn't until, I don't know, 30 years later that I saw larvae in the ground. I had no idea that there was a metamorphosis to this magical thing, that it just kept going. So the deeper and more closely I looked at things, the more wondrous the world became. So I started developing a technique, basically just being mindful and paying attention to things, and not necessarily assuming I know what I'm looking at anymore, and not relying on language and linguistics and taxonomies or ways of naming things. Once you name something, you shut down options. So, you know, my wife introduced me as Sean, but I'm so much more than that, right? Another person that fascinated me, I'm really interested in natural history, I'm kind of, I graze a lot in my own research for my work. And I might say too, I'm not gonna show any of my work in this lecture because it's not about that. And I don't make paintings about wonder. I don't think anybody can set out and say, today I'm going to make a wonderful painting, right? Because it's that thing that we can't quite articulate. I think it's the thing that makes us human. That we get to this point where we have to re-engage the world on new terms. Or we can ignore that. I think a lot of people get to that point, and it's difficult, and it might be stressful, and it might be inconvenient to get to a nuanced gray area. But if you want to engage that, that's where the action's at. So on the left-hand side, you have a sketch from the Dutch scientist Leeuwenhoek, who was one of the inventors of the microscope, and peered through it for the first time and saw these swimming little creatures. Can you imagine that? It's hard for us to imagine now. Being the first person to look through this device, which is a wonder in itself, and see things moving, that's amazing. And so one of the things that I like to do in my teaching, but also for my own work, whenever I'm stuck in sort of a mundane place, is to go back in the history. I'm particularly interested in pre-Enlightenment medicine, where it's real dodgy stuff. You don't want those people treating you. But it's really fascinating because they are working with limited means and they are trying to invent a way to figure out a problem. And you know, right now a lot of them are, it's very useless and dangerous, bloodletting for one. However, conceptually, there's a lot of creativity and imagination there that as an artist, I can mine. I can take these ideas that are outmoded, outdated, or plain dangerous, and I can apply them to my practice. Because as an artist, I have the freedom to be wrong because I'm never about being right. That's not my job. And in academia, when I'm teaching, I like to point out to the students and remind them, particularly the art majors, that we are the only department that traffics in subjectivity. I mean, it's completely subjective. We have to create our own works to model our ways of thinking or to perform a way of being in the world, and there's no indexical reference that a student can go to or guide or the back of the book to see the answers to know if they're there or not. So it requires a lot of vulnerability and faith to commit yourself to wonder. On the right-hand side is a Lebrun drawing of astonishment. This is Ed Ruscha, who's a contemporary artist and painter and photographer, and this was an artist book that he did of parking lots, just aerial photos of parking lots. And just putting them together creates this new experience of this very commonplace, mundane thing that you probably ignore every day, except for when you can't find a place to park, and then you're very upset. And then you lose all of that good sense of wonder. The next slide I'm going to show is a short clip from a documentary on David Wilson's Museum of Jurassic Technology in Culver City, California. Has anybody heard of this place before? Great. And Lawrence Weschler, who we were fortunate enough to interview for the catalog for this Wonder exhibition, wrote a great book on it called Mr. Wilson's Cabinet of Wonder. It's a small book, and if you crack it open, you will not put it down until you are done. So this is a documentary on David Wilson's museum. It's the strangest, most interesting place I have ever been. It is truly a wonder to behold. You don't know what's real, what's not real. It is a must, it's a bucket list thing. You gotta go there if you're a curious person. Thank you.
The spirit of David's Museum is one simultaneously of parody and of reverence. And the way this is braided together is absolutely of essence of this place. And that same thing happens over and over again. For example, the fruit stone carving here. According to the caption, it purports to show on one side a lion, a boar, a rabbit, two crows, like 50 animals. I just assumed that this is just a great, great parody of captions and of our credulity at captions in museums. It turns out there was indeed, in the 16th century, a fruit stone carving of exactly this size with all that stuff on it. In fact, it turns out that everything at this place is true. Kinda. Sorta.
David's fruit stone carving is essentially a peach pit that he just kind of put in there. But then you have the caption listing all of the things that are in the peach pit. And it begs you to believe. It creates a longing. I sat there looking at this thing for the longest time. It's just like looking at clouds and trying to see figures and creatures up there. And, you know, I thought I saw some. I started to believe. So you can see it's quite complicated. But the one in the Museum of Jurassic Technology is actually, he couldn't get a hold of one, so he just put a peach pit in there, a really interesting one. But, you know, in the next exhibit, it's totally authentic. And it just goes back and forth and back and forth through this whole museum. So one of the strategies I mentioned in that diagram, that map of wonder, that artists, I'm always speaking as an artist. That's important to emphasize. Like I said before, I'm not an academic. I like reading, I like school, I like all of these things, but I don't want to be an expert on anything. Because as an artist, I enjoy that quality of not knowing. I'm always fighting to get back to that place where I was as a child and I couldn't quite figure things out and I was left to my own inventions. So the grotesque and play are two concrete things that artists can do, teachers can do, people can do, or think about in order to prompt or provoke the potential to have some kind of experience akin to wonder. So we start off with Frankenstein's monster. And you can see that there's many different Frankenstein monsters. And it's important to know, too, that Frankenstein's monster is not called Frankenstein, as I've corrected my children many times. Does not have a name. The book is much more interesting than the film. By constructing these things, these creatures, you create something that shifts between readings. It's a person, but it's not a person. It's a monster. Yet it longs for love and humility. It's a very complicated, it's a way of containing opposing ideas, the grotesque. This could be considered a kind of grotesque arrangement as well. This is Fischli and Weiss, the Swiss artist, who did the very famous video, The Way Things Go, which is basically a giant Rube Goldberg project. I'm sure you guys have probably seen this. But they also did these kind of fantastical balanced sculpture shots. But so does my son, Emmett. And in some ways, his are even better, because this is actually a spaceship. So, you know, I'm pointing this out, like here we have grown-ups and here we have children. These grown-ups have a job, and that's their job. And these children don't have a job, they just play. Another artist that I think about a lot in relation to wonder is Tom Friedman, who is one of my heroes. He's a sculptor. He is included in the exhibition at Mass MoCA as well. He has a brand new piece, so I have no image of it whatsoever. But in these two pieces, on the left is basically a box of spaghetti. that is wetted and then fused together and dried end to end into a continual loop. And then it's dried and it's put there. The piece on the right is, oh, the horror of horrors, hair and soap. But he sits there and he very very thoughtfully and carefully and mindfully creates this perfect spiral and puts that up there. So he's always using these mundane household materials and then generating something that is truly, absolutely mind-blowing. Tom Friedman shows are one of the best experiences one can have. Okay, I could go on about him forever, but I won't. Learned ignorance. This is a term that goes all the way back to 17th century theologian, philosopher Nicholas of Cusa, and who wrote a text actually on learned ignorance. And then we can fast forward to Donald Rumsfeld, which this quote, as much as that period of the war in which and the way he would relate to journalists infuriated me, this quote was astonishing. I mean, it really is an interesting thing to think about. As we know, there are known knowns. There are things we know. We also know there are known unknowns. That is to say, we know there are some things we do not know, but there are also unknown unknowns. The ones we don't know, we don't know. That is a really rich statement, and it's really extraordinary to pick apart and think about things, to think about the ineffable, to think about, to question what you really know. I mean, that's a pretty good springboard to provoke students or your own self when you're thinking about ways to fully be present in your life, to experience the wonder of every day. It's hard to do that, especially when you're grown up. You get into autopilot. David Foster Wallace in his Kenyon commencement address talks about that beautifully. Which I would recommend as well. I came across this image, Teach Yourself Ignorance, and looked for this book for a long time, only to find out that it is a drawing. And then, of course, next to it, we have I Want to Believe, the X-Files poster. So ignorance and failure are something that I'm really excited about, because failure allows a certain kind of an opening to happen, like in relation to play. Okay, you can fail and work, correct? If you fail at work, you're in big trouble. But if you fail at play, can you fail at play? Maybe, no, I think maybe you try something different or you shift your attitude, or my daughter Adeline kicks Emmett out of her room so that she can play according to her rules. So play and work, two four-letter words, are interesting things to remember and to work against each other. So this ignorance thing is really hip right now. As proven by this next slide, published by Routledge, nonetheless, the Routledge International Handbook of Ignorance Studies. This is a real thing. So this is really something that artists have been doing a long time, is being ignorant, willfully ignorant, or learned ignorance, as Nicholas of Cusa talked about it. So, you know, this is a familiar painting to all of you in the museum. And when we had the optic nerve show here years ago, that was quite an occasion to have your mind blown and your retinas fatigued. Because that's basically what's happening. You can't process what you are looking at cognitively. And so your brain is submitting information. It's guessing. It's making its best guess as to how to perceive this thing. So it's a sensory overload. It's a really interesting moment where it's completely privative, it's private, it's very democratic. Whoever's standing in front of that thing owns that experience. And nobody else can share that same set of eyes that you're seeing. This is an artist, Nina Cacciadorian, who is going to be in the Wonder Show. She embodies the attitude of play and this kind of, I think all of her work has some condition, some quality of wonder to it. This was a project where she was at her family's cabin and noticed all these broken spider webs and decided that she would repair them for the spiders. And she created a spider web repair kit, and there was a beautiful exhibition of these photographs. And in doing the studio visit with her, I adore these things, because they're so simple. It's such a simple, beautiful idea. And she told me that the spiders hated it. Every time they would go and they would take the pieces out. So, like, by the next morning, she would go out and they'd all be on the ground. Like, total art critic. Like, completely unsuccessful. So, one of the projects she's working on for us for the Explode Everyday exhibition is this amazing experience she and her brother had when they were children. She's Armenian and Finnish in heritage, and so they go to Finland often, to this cabin, and the kids were playing with their when they were children, they were playing with Playmobil people, or as my daughter calls them, Playmo people, which we let her do because I think that sounds better. So this project, what happened was a couple of the Playmo people got swept out to sea and were lost forever. And this was a huge thing. They were absolutely, completely distraught. And the pictures you see on the left is basically a recarcassing ceremony. So what happened was, of course you can go out, and if you have children and you've lost a favorite toy and you've gone out to buy a replacement toy, they always know that it is not the real thing. So her and her brother went through this process of basically resurrecting the souls of these Playmo people and putting them back into the identical missing ones so that they could join the community again. They're children at this point. As an aside, Nina was also part of, and still is, of the famous marshmallow experiment. So maybe that's where she gets all of this. So they were 12 and 9 years old. Every summer they would travel from their home in Northern California to a family cabin in Finland. And they played elaborate games with Playmobiles. They had two families of Playmobiles. Their presence is so important that they appear in the family photos. And then two particularly important characters were lost and were suddenly taken by undertow. Kai immediately tried to rescue them as Nina stood yelling at him from the shore, afraid he would get swept away too. Kai survived, but Maddie and Steve did not. The next summer, while in Finland, Nina and Kai held what they called a recarcassing ceremony in order to transfer the souls of the departed characters into a new blank figure bought for this purpose. Both human and Playmobil family members attended the ceremony, which Nina and Kai recorded on audio cassette. So we'll have that ceremony playing along with the documentation of the exhibition. So that little synopsis is from my colleague, Denise Markanish, who is the chief, or one of the two curators at Mass MoCA. I am merely a visitor. I'm an amateur curator. So this is a thing that we like to think about as children. My son just yesterday told me that Bigfoot is indeed real. He decided that Bigfoot's real. And I was in an exhibition on cryptozoology, which is a search for hidden animals, like, you know, Loch Ness Monster, Bigfoot, the Yeti. But cryptozoology also has some legitimacy to it in that they're the ones that talked about the giant squid, the panda, the okapi, these animals which are discovered. And once they're discovered, they get swept into science. And they leave sort of the realm of myth and folklore and legend. So explanation separates us from astonishment, which is the only gateway to the incomprehensible, by Eugene Ionesco, the absurdist French playwright. So I think the important thing is that we can all choose to see in particular ways. I mean, you can leave here today and decide to view your world differently, and it will change dramatically. People might start looking at you strange. I always get comments when I'm out in the parking lot taking photographs of clouds. People will stop and say, oh, well, the one guy in Maine, I mean, the clouds there are amazing. We have good clouds here too, but it's because of the ocean and the weather. And so one guy came out and I was in the grocery store parking lot looking up and just taking tons of pictures, and he stood next to me and he said, is that something I should be noticing? I swear to God, he said that. And I just pointed, I said, look at that. He's like, yeah, those are pretty cool clouds. And then he left and went away. But I wanted to have a deeper relationship with that particular sunset. The other thing, you know, a lot of this is training of vision. I mean, these are these magic eye pictures, which we all have seen by now. But you know, this is a good analogy for the way that I think you need to approach the topic of wonder, where you're kind of trying to focus on it, but you're losing focus at the same time, and you're trying to see in between this two-dimensional plane and discover some kind of form in there. Again, you have to have belief that you can do it. There are still people who can't do this, and it's very difficult. One form begetting another form, shadow puppets. The sleep of reason produces monsters, the famous Goya etching. And then excess reason produces monsters. That whole unfortunate era of 19th and early 20th century medicine, where it was all based on visual typing, or phrenology, or physiognomy of face, or race, or appearance, or physical attributes. I mean, that was science. Being trapped between these extremes leads to complacency and eliminates our capacity for wonder. So, you know, this homogenization that happens where everybody's kind of pursuing the same goals and same dreams is something as an artist that I really want to get away from. I like things like this, which you'll never see in a medical textbook. Currently, these kind of Baroque, almost celebratory anatomical textbooks from the 17th and 18th centuries. Little things like soap bubbles. And then three of the most interesting people that I think about all the time, who I would consider conceptual artists, especially P.T. Barnum on the left, Benjamin Franklin in the middle, and then Charles Fort on the right. I'm sorry, I'm looking at the wrong thing. So we have Edith Cobb again. I think this is a mistake. And so this was, I've shown this picture a lot because this is my experience with the museum has done these dispatch projects where you go around town and you repair things with Legos and you take pictures and you upload them to this website of this one artist. And these are done all over the world. But I was in Berlin and I was alone and I was walking around and I was kind of bummed out, a little depressed. And I went down an alley. I decided to get off the roads and go down alleys. And I saw this. I had heard about these. This is the first one I saw. And so this was kind of a miraculous moment for me. This was a gift. This changed my entire demeanor for the rest of the trip. So, I mean, you can set up conditions where people don't expect something special to happen. And that's a really good place to go for it. The other thing that artists do is they work for this. I mean, this is a craft. You work to the point where, you know, this is a back room at the Museum of Natural History, all the sketches, all the maquettes. You work so that ultimately you disappear in a way, and that the work remains there, powerful in itself, almost a medium in the supernatural sense, between knowing and not knowing. So provoking wonder and organizing experience, the grotesque, a form and strategy and method of making, conceptualizing, and generatively not understanding problems and creating expansive encounters. The grotesque can be considered something that is more than or different than its parts. Play, the process of working, making, and becoming. And the conditions of wonder, which I mentioned before, the marvelous, the fantastic. The fantastic not being fantasy, but being a hesitation. A hesitation that you have between where you cannot decide whether the thing that you are witnessing or the phenomena that you're involved in is of natural or supernatural origins. If it starts to be a supernatural in origin, it veers into the realm of the uncanny. If it ends up having a natural explanation, it veers into the realm of the marvelous. In making these, trying to figure out negotiating wonder, I employed the thing that I always do, is associative thinking, where I'm trying to make big leaps between things. I like to bastardize art history. I like to mess with the canon and create my own relationships to these ideas. So mind maps are pretty fun to do. This one is pretty amazing. I mean, that's kind of a wonder to behold, that we even tried to get involved in that. And then we get to the one that I've been working on. And in making this, it's mostly a teaching tool, and it's just a way for me to consider zones. Like, are we closer to this being a darker experience of wonder? Is this something fantastic that I found on the beach? Maybe that's a material experience. And then how can I translate these things into something that I can do in the studio, or that the students can process in order to make their work somehow other than just themselves, than the typical work of art? This is a document in OSU archives from the SETI project, the Search for Extraterrestrial Intelligence. Which is actually a real thing. And Jill Tarter, who is the founder of SETI, has written an essay for the catalog as well. We made sure to get a cognitive psychologist, scientists, comedians, all different kinds of people writing for this catalog. So this is, they picked up a signal that, you can see the wow next to it. They picked up a signal that indicated some kind of cohesive intelligence coming at us from distant galaxies. So you may know the movie Contact. That's based on Jill Tarter. And was, you know, this was written by Carl Sagan. And I'll play this clip for you.
Celestial event. No words to describe it. Poetry. They should have said a poet.
So beautiful.
so beautiful. I had no idea.
This is a work by Fred Tomaselli. This was one of his earliest works. If you know his paintings, this is a very strange thing. These are cubic galaxies. He sat down with star maps, gridded off every one, painted plexiglass with different kinds of paint, and painstakingly created a cubic universe. So these are actual representations of the universe folded up into cubes and hung from the ceiling. It's a very simple gesture, but it's a really, really beautiful and strong work that'll be in the show. It's a very famous picture from the 2008 Obama campaign of this girl seeing Obama walk out on the stage. Again, the wonder face. I'm going to speed it up a little bit because I know I'm going slow. To lose yourself, a voluptuous surrender, lost in your arms, lost to the world, utterly immersed in what is present so that its surroundings fade away. In Benjamin's terms, to be lost is to be fully present, is to be capable of being in uncertainty and mystery. And one does not get lost, but loses oneself, with the implication that it is a conscious choice, a chosen surrender, a psychic state achievable through geography. Rebecca Solnit, the great writer, in her Field Guide to Getting Lost. So Dark Wonder, I talked a little bit about the uncanny and the fantastic. And this is a diagram. The pure fantastic is that hesitation. The best example, or the most common example that I think many people can relate to, is the movie The Sixth Sense. If you remember that, I see dead people. And we don't know in the movie until towards the end that Bruce Willis is actually dead. So he keeps you in suspense that entire time. You can't quite figure it out. The moment that you understand that he's dead, you have left the realm of the fantastic. Just like in Wonder, the moment you question this experience you're having, it's done. You're in the realm of curiosity at that point. That's where you're starting to construct a relationship to the experience. You're not fully present in the experience. This is a Sam Taylor Wood photograph that I like to use when I'm talking about the fantastic. Plausible, probably not true, but maybe, I don't know. That's a really nice state to be in. I think it's one of those states that is most akin to wonder. The person that wrote about the fantastic a lot is a scholar by the last name of Todorov. This is one of the plates in Charles Darwin's Origin of Species. This is Expression of Terror. Here's another one. It's from The Shining. And then this is the one, when I was researching and reading these books, especially Philip Fisher's book, and he was talking about the aesthetics of rare experience. And I started asking myself, what is my rare experience, or have I had one? And I couldn't think about it until, and this is where negotiating all these other terms came into play. I started thinking about horror. The one experience that I had that changed everything, that completely broke me down emotionally. It was the horror of it. It was the abject terror. It was the fantastic hesitation of what's going on. It was my students saying to me, Sean, what's going to happen? And me not being able to know. Nobody knew what was. We all remember this. This moment just should not have happened. This is still within the realm of wonder. It's on the darker side. It's closer to horror and terror. Those inexplicable acts that make no sense. So I like to go to the Buddhist monk next. A creative event does not grasp. It does not take possession. It is an excursion. More often than not, it requires that one leaves the realm of the known and takes oneself there where one does not expect it, is not expected to be. There's no prescriptive procedure to be applied mechanically, no recipes to follow, and no model to emulate. And Descartes says once again, I saw this in a spider web outside my front door, it's a paint chip. I went down to get the bird seed to fill up the bird feeder, and that's how I noticed it, which is one technique that you can do in your daily life is to bend down. And if you have kids, you know, they're always finding cool things on the ground that you used to find when you're kids, and you think they're gone now, but they're not, just because you're taller and you're not as close to the ground. So this floating paint chip was pretty amazing. And Descartes says, and it can be said in particular of wonder that it's useful in making us learn and retain in our memory things we have previously been ignorant of, for we wonder only what appears rare and extraordinary to us. Art and science is, we talk about that a lot in the Wonder exhibition and the catalog. And for me, I mentioned earlier that in a university or a college, the art department is the subjective realm. That's what we can do. So, you know, my poor scientist friends, they start with their question, they go through all these processes just like we do in their lab, our studio, and if the hypothesis is false, they have to do it over again. It becomes kind of excess data. And that's the thing that character Charles Fort did. He wrote this book called The Damned, and he spent his minor inheritance going through the British Library and the Library of Congress collecting information of things that were damned by science. In other words, phenomena that science couldn't explain and then put aside. Things such as raining frogs, which actually happens. And he would put together this book about how miraculous the world was within science, but science had this kind of agenda and this dogma to it that, if it didn't conform to the hypothesis, you get rid of it. But for an artist, that's awesome. And these things are awesome. And this is our relationship to art and science. I mean, we can play around with these ideas and we can go back into science. We can take it as seriously, or I can look at my own painting, my own body of work in this way. And that can be a way to order things. So it's not that different from making art. Creativity is simply a different form of cognitive growth. It is associative and analogical. These skills are essential to navigate the complexity of our lives, globalization, the internet, etc. This is by Peter Sheldahl, the critic for the New Yorker, I believe. Yes, the New Yorker, who's a poet originally, but he's a very significant art critic. And he mentioned this in a lecture once, and it really struck me. And I think it relates to the mission that the Columbus Museum of Art has in terms of art being an essential component to our being in this world and our knowing the world in intelligent and thoughtful ways. Sheldahl says, art is commonly, even persuasively, used to illustrate the complexities of scientific squabbles, and yet, rarely, if ever, is it afforded an authority or respect as a kind of third estate in the oppositional struggles of science, sociology, politics, and all post-industrial modernist dualities. Things that are contradictory outside art are not contradictory inside art. So you saw this image before. This is my daughter, our daughter, Adeline. We were walking down the street and she was tugging at my arm and I was lost in thought about all the things I had to do. We were on holiday in Provincetown and we were spending a lot of money and I was worried about bills and I had to make dinner and all this stuff and I was not paying attention to my daughter who was leaping constantly. And it was like that annoying thing like, Adeline, stop it. And I was lost in my world. I didn't get out of my pattern. So finally I looked down as she was making a jump, ready to scold her. And as if she was talking to herself, she just said, I'm going to jump over my shadow. I'm going to jump over my shadow. I can do it. And at that moment, I felt like an idiot. And And I felt blessed to that was like a wonder moment for me that I start getting emotional about. And she was having that. She was playing. So, you know, the wonder and play are very, very closely linked. I would suggest that they're, you know, two sides of the same coin even. Again, Eugene Ionesco, the playwright. In all cities of the world, it is the same. The universal and the modern man is a man in a rush, a man who has no time, who is a prisoner of necessity, who cannot understand that a thing might perhaps be without usefulness, nor does he understand that at bottom, it is the useful that may be a useless and backbreaking burden. If one does not understand the usefulness of the useless and the uselessness of the useful, one cannot understand art. And a country where art is not understood is a country of slaves and robots. These next two images are Magritte. This is his famous painting, The Treachery of Images, titled This Is Not a Pipe. It's a representation of a pipe. It's actually paint. It's a very complex painting. It's a very complex philosophical offering. And then this is another very famous work by the American conceptual artist, one of the fathers of conceptualism, Joseph Kossuth, One in Three Chairs, considering the semiotics of a chair. You know, what is a chair? Is it the definition? Is it the actual physical object? Is it the representation? The physical object is actually wood. Maybe it's not chair. What is chairness? So all of these things that we think we know and we name are malleable. None of these things are fixed. And I know when you're teaching, if you're teaching in elementary or public school, any school these days, and you're dealing with standardized testing, it's driving you crazy. But encouraging students to think broadly, you can do that. You can kind of sneak it in under the radar. This is a really fascinating document. This was the 9/11 Commission report, and it talks about the four kinds. We believe the 9/11 attacks revealed four kinds of failures. The first one listed is in imagination, then policy, capabilities, and management. And the dots next to it is that it's that famous puzzle, like you only have three lines and you have to connect all the dots. Have you guys done this puzzle before? And basically, the solution is not to stay within the area that you perceive. It's to go way down past the dots into the zone which you don't know if you're allowed to go, so that you can shoot back up and get more dots and then come back down again. So you're way outside where you're supposed to be, thinking outside the box. The in-between, again, the magnets, the in-between. So when we're talking about wonder, you can also be talking about the in-between, which is a theoretical and philosophical concept that people like Elizabeth Gross and Gilles Deleuze and Félix Guattari talk about a lot in their work. These are some just general ideas. Pataphysics is one of my favorite things, the science of imaginary solutions. You can be a pataphysician. That's a really fun thing to think about. And there's some very serious work that talks about that. Quasi-object is a term that a French theorist, Michel Serre, came up with in his book, The Parasite, the strangest, most interesting, most challenging book I've ever read in my life. And it's used by his good buddy, Bruno Latour. So for Serres, a quasi-object resembles Winnicott's transitional object. The quasi-object is not an object, but is one nevertheless, since it is not a subject. Since it is in the world, it is also a quasi-subject, since it marks or designates a subject who, without it, would not be a subject. Sounds like Rumsfeld again. He has a great example in there talking basically about soccer. Like, who gives the ball agency? Is the ball the subject or the player? When the player hits the ball, then there's a connection. So this is a constantly mutating system. And And Bruno Latour is a very interesting social scientist, so he talks about these ideas in his work. The liminal, Victor Turner is very famous for writing about the liminal. Indeterminacy, if you want to think about John Cage and chance operations and procedures. And then this is a Deleuze quote talking about the middle. I think I'm going to let you read this so I can speed up. I like at the end, he says, try it. You'll see that everything changes. So we have Joseph Albers, the famous painter. I mean, we have some Albers here in the museum. Teacher at Black Mountain College, Yale. Amazing colorist. Just, I mean, honestly, I don't think American art would be what it is without Albers coming over here. His famous equation is 1 + 1 = 3. And he would do this all the time, 1 + 1 = 3. And he's talking about the gap between 1 + 1. So he's talking about wonder in a sense. And that is the nature of visual art, right? You have figure-ground relationships. So you can have the figure, you can have the ground, and then you can flip them, and then you can have something, an image, come out of the figure or the ground, like the two faces or the candlestick illusion. This is a great quote by Michel Foucault. I dream of a new age of curiosity. We have the technical means for it, the desire is there, the things to be known are infinite, the people who can employ themselves at this task exist. Why do we suffer? From too little, from channels that are too narrow, skimpy, quasi-monopolistic, insufficient. There is no point in adopting a quasi-protectionist attitude to prevent bad information from invading and suffocating the, quote, good information. Rather, we must simply multiply the paths and possibilities of comings and goings. These are children looking at Joseph Cornell box. I'm really going to go through these quickly because I'm out of time. We talk about play as an activity which precedes the certain limits of time and space in a visible order according to rules freely accepted and outside the sphere of necessity or material utility. The play mood is one of rapture and enthusiasm and is sacred or festive in accordance with the occasion. A feeling of exaltation and tension accompanies the action. And we have Ray Bradbury, from whom the exhibition is named. You remain invested in your inner child by exploding every day. You don't worry about the future. You don't worry about the past. You just explode. And we're just about there. So I want to show you two video clips in total. There are 4 minutes. Would that be okay? Okay. This is from the great film Wings of Desire by Wim Wenders.
Ist das rot?
Ja.
Haben Sie sich verletzt?
Heute geht's gut.
Gut.
Und die Rohre?
Rohre sind gelb.
Gelb?
Ja.
Und der da?
Der ist graublau.
Graublau. Der?
Lila.
Der?
Der ist orange. Ocker.
Ocker? Oder orange?
Ocker.
Ocker. Gelb, rot.
Das ist gelb, ja.
Der?
Der ist grün.
Grün. Und das oben, über dem Auge?
Das ist blau.
Das ist blau. Blau. Ist es heute sehr kalt?
Ah, oh, es geht vorbei.
Ah, ich würde so gerne einen Kaffee trinken.
Haben Sie kein Geld?
Ja. Nein. Das freut mich, dass es heute so gut geht. Danke.
So this is, I will read this and then I will end with a beautiful video. This is from Tom Robbins, Even Cowgirls Get the Blues. Suppose you awoke one morning with the uneasy feeling that the world had while you slept somehow slipped a tilt and rose to find that your dresser drawers were mysteriously open a fraction of an inch and that prescription bottles had tipped over in the medicine cabinet, although neither you nor anyone else in your household had ventured since bedtime to get an aspirin, a condom, or a Tums. And that pictures on your wall, shades on the lamps, and books in the case were askew. Outdoors, the taller buildings were posing a la Pisa, or should you live in the country, streams were running slightly outside their grooves as fruit dropped like gargoyle ganglia from uniformly leaning trees. What would be your reaction to such a phenomenon? Honestly now, and seriously too, how would you feel? Would you be scared, confused, puzzled, and anxious? Would you telephone the police? Would you pray? Or would you numbly await an explanation, refusing to attempt to analyze the event or even to experience it with your full emotions until you had read the papers, tuned in the news, heard how experts from the universities were explaining the tilt, learned how the Pentagon planned to deal with it, were reassured by the president, who might insist, as presidents will, that nothing, really nothing, had gone wrong? Or instead of fear, bewilderment, and anxiety, or in addition to fear, bewilderment, and anxiety, or instead of a hard impulse to dismiss the happening and get back to business as usual, or in addition to a hard impulse to dismiss the happening and get back to business as usual, do you imagine that a bright trace of delight, unnameable and indefensible, might tickle your spine? Could you feel in an odd way elated? Elated, perhaps, because in a rational world where even disasters are familiar and damn near routine, something of an almost fairy tale flavor had occurred. Thank you.
What I've done is ask two of my colleagues who, I will admit, Sean is my primary thought partner, but I do cheat on him with these two. So, but what we have is Marily Mostov. She's the chief engagement officer here at the Columbus Museum of Art. She also is the brainchild and the primary curator of the Wonder Room, which is a space here at the museum where she has been thinking deeply about how do we evoke this in these spaces? How do we make it aware for our visitors and for our public? Fred Burton is faculty of education at Ashland University, teaches at Harvard's Project Zero in the summer. He's also part of our team and is the co-director with Jen Leahy for the Making Creativity Visible grant. He wrote a great article on where's wonder in the education setting. So I'm going to have the two of you actually respond to Sean's prompts and just take a little bit of time here to have a dialogue about what your thinking is and how does this relate to the rest of us. You will have in 3 seconds. Sean's already hooked up, but you guys will have your own mics.
Thanks. You want to go ahead?
Sure.
Okay,
check.
So
do a check first.
Sean, first of all, I want to thank you for a wonderful presentation and provoking, I know me and I hope everyone else, to really think differently. I wrote a lot of ideas down, and thank you for giving me some reading material for the next 3 months. And I know I'm going to be looking down all day long after that last video. But so I wrote a lot, and I like to make thought bubble maps, too, like Sean. So I'm going to start with the bottom one, which Cindy mentioned, thought partners. And I noticed, Sean, that you mentioned three people that influence you, three white men, mm-hmm. just going to point out, that Barnum, Benjamin Franklin, and I didn't know the last one, Fort?
Charles Fort.
Yep. So I kept circling that while you're talking and thinking, like, I wonder who their thought partners are or were, and I wonder if they had great, strong women like Cindy Foley as Probably. Their thought, or men. But and then that got me thinking when you talked about Dear Addie. I love Cindy and Sean's children, Addie and Emmett, and because I'm an empty nester, I actually have to import them sometimes to my house. And so then I thought, do we all need to think about and make our own graphs of who our thought partners are and who our play partners are? Because Addie is a great partner of, or who our wonder partners are, like Addie. And I was thinking for myself even that my dogs are that for me. They serve the role of Addie when I don't have children around. So I started making all these graphs of all these partners I have to help me provoke my wonder and my play, because I think a lot about play.
There's a lot of interesting folks out here. I mean, just at my table, there are teachers, there's a physician, had a great... And this physician, she's saying, you know, there's a place for wonder in the health field and all of that. And then we started talking about, well, I said, well, I don't know if I want my pharmacist to be really creative or, you know, when I go to the pharmacy. But then we started thinking, well, maybe that wouldn't be such a bad idea, you know, the possibilities of pharmacists getting really creative next time you go to CVS. I'm thinking of a couple best hopes that I'm taking away and worst fear. One of the best hopes is that Sean always talks about joy and discovery. And as I'm thinking about, boy, for teachers or for office workers or for physicians or for whatever where you happen to live your work lives or home lives, you know, when I'm in schools, that's where I mostly hang out with, or teachers, I'm not seeing quite the joy that I used to see. And people have taken away that joy, and when you don't have joyful teachers, you don't have joyful kids as well. I've been encouraged by some of my recent hanging outs, like in Dublin City Schools and what they're doing. It's been pretty amazing to see. But I think that's one takeaway. Where is there joy and where is there discovery in your classroom, your office, or wherever you happen to work? Another best hope I have, taken from you in reading one of your essays, I know that you stare at things a lot. Are you staring at me right now? No. That you stare at paint your own paintings. You stare at paintings for hours. You stare at clouds. And to make the familiar strange, what anthropologists do as well. And I'm thinking, okay, as a teacher or in your office, why don't you stare? What if we stared at our practice a little bit and go and make that what's familiar a little strange? It might be your morning meetings if you're in a classroom teacher, or how you assess, or that sort of thing. So I think that would be kind of wonderful. I actually had a conversation with two teachers from Eli Penny, which is a school in Dublin, Katrina and Jennifer. They're second grade teachers, and the kids like to sit on the floor, so they said, well, let's just take the legs off our desk and put them on the floor, and what could, you know, what's the worst that could happen? And I just thought, you know, they were game for making the familiar strange with kids, and what could the worst that could happen? And then I think the kind of a last hope is playfulness, and that's what this museum does incredibly well. Mary Lee does it. Cindy has kind of been the visionary for this at the museum forever. And what happened to playfulness in your work setting or in our classrooms? Because I know in education there's been this erosion of childhood. We've kind of taken, we're stealing childhood, like we're going back to the Middle Ages where there wasn't childhood, wasn't around. And so that kind of led to my worst fear as you were talking, and that is that policymakers will embrace this idea of wonder and curiosity and creativity, and then they'll destroy it by testing it. They'll want to boil it down to that, and I think that's about the quickest way to undo wonder is to then test it. They're already doing that with grit. Grit's very important, we're finding, with kids, but they're already testing it, and so I hope that doesn't happen. I'm always astonished to hear you. I'm always hopeful when I hear you, and I'd like to, you know, carry that hope in conversation with people here. You know, what was it about some of the things that Sean said that just really provoked you in some way or made you think a little bit more? And nicely done again. I appreciate your talk.
Thanks.
Sean, do you want to respond to anything they said?
No. Oh, okay. it was a lot there, and I had responses coming and going the whole time. One thing, Fred, as you were just talking about classrooms and keeping a sense of wonder within all of these constraints, it's not directly applicable to primary, middle, and secondary school, but maybe. I mean, it depends on how their schedules are laid out and how much risk the teachers want to take. Like in relation to their administrators. But probably the best course or the best class I ever had as a teacher, and all of the students agreed, was I taught a follow-up course at OSU, another graduate course called Morphology of Wonder, where we were looking at it from studio artist's point of view, where it was like, can we actually make something? You know, is there... You know, we can play with formal elements like scale. If you make something really big, people are going to respond to that in a way that's outside the normal response range. If you make it miniature, they'll respond to it. You know, things like that. And in that class, we kept going back again and again to our own early childhood educational experiences. And in realizing how important it was, one student had done Montessori. We talked a lot about kindergarten as it originally was conceived by Froebel, with the gifts and how it was this haptic, geometric, kind of beautiful, encapsulating experience for children back then, the real kindergarten, where they embodied a kind of knowledge. And Reggio too, we talked about Reggio. And it kept coming back to them. They kept talking about where they lost it. They kept trying to identify points like, oh, it was in middle school when I had this particular chemistry teacher who was really inflexible about the fact that I wanted to talk about how pretty the diagrams looked, or something like that. So over a few weeks of having these discussions, always go back to that, we decided to have a field trip day, which was just outside of Hayes Hall on the Oval. We just spent the whole day on the Oval. And they had made some projects and kind of spread them around for us to find or not find. And it was the most enjoyable, memorable experience that we had together as a class the whole year. And I know that they all agreed. I mean, we were out there talking about ideas and we were discovering stuff. We felt a little bit like we were kids, like creeping through backyards. We broke into a couple buildings. We didn't break into them, but we weren't authorized to be in them, but we wanted to see. So, you know, these are all graduate students and myself, and just changing the dynamic of the class like that one time really shifted the remainder of the term and made it important for me to always create some kind of field trip or something like that where the students are bonding and they're gathering shared experience outside of the collection of knowledge so that it's more applicable to their lives in some way.
I think what I hear you saying, Sean, and I know I agree, and some of my colleagues back here who I work with, that it sounds like you staged an experience or a learning experience to really kind of set the stage or the environment or the conditions for those wonder moments. And I have some colleagues, Kat, back there, that we recently presented at a conference where and even the wonder room, we can't make wonder happen. Just like I love how you said, I can't make a painting or work of art about wonder, but we certainly can try to set the stage or the conditions or an environment that might make it more fruitful or the possibility for it to happen. And also what I learned from watching this last, was that Addie in the last video?
No.
That wasn't Addie, their darling, which it could have been.
No,
you could have told me what. But we also can document it. And I know Fred's come on board to our museum and really taught us a lot about using photography to document or that video to document. And so I'm thinking of when Jen came up and there's a hashtag creativity summit, and I feel challenged myself, and maybe I'll put out the challenge to all of you, is when you're here for this creativity summit, how can you document moments of wonder? Can you document? And maybe we'll be successful, and maybe we won't, but that's my personal challenge now, even for this weekend, to put on the hashtag is, how can I document moments of wonder? And I'm gonna have to get my phone with me, because I don't have it right now.
I mean, one way I think that you can do it readily, and you see it on Instagram a lot, which is always fun to look at, is to crop your field of vision. You know, don't be scanning, you know, for the person. I mean, if I'm looking at Fred, and then I go to look at Cindy, I've missed all of you. I have no idea what I didn't see anything. You know, but if I stop, I have choices to look from Fred to Cindy. I can look at all your heads. I can look at the bottom of all the tablecloths. I can look midway across and see green bands. You know, I have all these different options. I have choices of looking and seeing, but you get on autopilot. And I know it's, I mean, one of the things that I encourage students to do, especially beginning painting and drawing courses, I'll give them a lecture and contextualize it all and get them all excited, and then ask them to walk home and observe everything they can possibly see. And they can't, their brain will explode. I mean, you have to abstract your reality constantly. So if you zoom in on things, and there are some great Instagram accounts where people do that, you know, they start to develop. It's like an athlete, like training. You start to develop a capacity to notice things on a regular basis.
Yeah, I know you talk about mindfulness and cultivating being awake.
Yeah.
It makes a big difference. I do want to ask one quick question because it's been on my mind. Where did that last video come from? Because that was an amazing, beautiful video.
That's a friend of mine in Maine, and it's their daughter. Yeah. Yeah, and they I saw it, and I asked. I said, can I please use that? It is a really remarkable document. I mean, I've never seen anything like it. It's truly wonderful and amazing and so fortunate that they caught that. You know, and I guess that's the other thing, is that we all have these phones now, or most of us, and, you know, you can do so many things with them. But then, you know, it's the tyranny of data, right? After you download all that stuff, you have to sort through it. But you can turn that into a practice too. I mean, that can be like another layer of discovery. You know, you download them and you zoom into things, or you play with the contrast or the exposure, and suddenly dark pictures, people emerge out of them like ghosts. So, you know, having the phones, I mean, it's changed the way that I experience the world a lot. As a painter, I do wish people would look at paintings longer instead of taking pictures of them and walking away. But, you know, that's just the way people are, I guess. Mm-hmm.